talking on the way in, and we were trying to guess how many people would show up today, and I have to tell you, you guys have exceeded our expectations, so praise God, and I thank God for all of you and wanting to weather the cold and the snowy roads out there. So I'd like to start our service out with reading Psalm 95. Verses 1 through 7, and I'm going to use the Message, which is a paraphrase. It says, "Come, let's shout praises to God. Raise the roof for the rock who saved us. Let's march into his presence, singing praises, lifting the rafters with our hymns. And why? Because God is the best, high king over all the gods. In one hand he holds deep caves and caverns, and the other hand grasps the high mountains. He made the ocean, he owns it. His hand sculpted the earth. So come, let us worship, bow before him on your knees before God who made us. Oh yes, he's our God, and we're the people of his pasture, the flock that he feeds. Let's get fed today as we have church. Amen."
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
How was everybody this cold morning?
Great.
It is January, and it is Northeast Ohio, so you know, we probably ought to assume we're going to see snow sometime. At least he blessed us with some nice sunny weather today. Before I start the announcements, I have a special announcement. If you'll indulge me, I'll share it with you. On December 30th, my son, Phil, the one in Denver, and his wife, Erin, had a new baby girl, which makes us first-time grandparents ever, which is all very exciting. But the exciting part, and the reason I share it this morning, is that all three of my kids had a very special relationship with my mom. And many of you know my mom or knew my mom. And Phil and Erin have chosen the name of their baby, Janet. So, isn't that great? So, I was very moved by that. And I'm going to head out there in a week or two and see the new baby. So thank you for letting me share that. But I know that those of you who knew my mom would know why my kids were bonding with her. She was a terrific lady. Okay, some announcements. Sense Bullet, of course, continues to occur at 9:30, and everyone is certainly welcome to that. Bible study occurs on Wednesdays at 11, and that continues this week. Choir practice is a continuing thing on Thursday evenings at 6:30. There is a one board meeting on January 17th, which would be Wednesday, right? At 5:30. And then in the category of can't miss events, Chef Brad's brunch is next Sunday after the worship service. An exciting announcement, February 11th, Mark Allen Chapman will be here in concert at 7 o'clock. Again, can't want to miss that kind of event. Any other announcements to share with the congregation today? Seeing none, if you'll join with me in the opening prayer. Blessed Lord, you are the King of heaven and earth. All of heaven sings in your glory. You do wonders on earth and heaven. We see the work of your hands as we gather in fellowship to worship you today. Come down and allow us to feel your presence. As we continue today's church service, we want to feel your great power and light. Let us encounter you in a new way and bless us in our lives. May we find everlasting joy for you. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Please stand and join in the opening hymn, Open My Eyes That I May See, number 454 of the Red and White. God calls to us. Are you listening?
Speak, Lord, your servants are listening.
The hands of God beckon us. Are you paying attention?
Show us, Lord, your servants are paying attention.
The love of God asks us, are you ready to follow?
Guide us, Lord, and we, your servants, will follow.
Come, let us worship the God whose tenacious love never stops calling and beckoning and asking us to follow.
Thanks be to God.
Are there any praises or concerns that anybody would like to share?
I'd like to ask if my brother Charles wanted to prayer for me on undergoing surgeries.
Thanks for reminding me about that. Victoria? Is that a prayer? She's praying for McDonald's after church.
So. Thanks for all the people that keep the roads and the lots clear. And the ones, the line workers that have to work in the cold.
Keep the Hum family in our prayers. Those of you that don't know, Wilma Hum passed away this past week, so keep them in prayer. Okay, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Oh, dear Heavenly Father, we come into your presence today to worship and praise your name. Thank you for the opportunity that is set before us to do so freely in a country that is still always allows us to do so. You are the God who created us to enjoy your creation, to fellowship with you and to serve you, so that others may come to know you and your awesome love, your compassion, your mercy and your grace that you extend to all that believe in you. You know our hearts, and yet you still love us and work towards guiding us in the right way. We don't always hear you due to the distractions of the world. We don't always see you due to the blindness that comes from the love of worldly things. We don't always follow you due to the fear of failure and the consciousness of our iniquities. But you are a bigger God than we can fathom. So help us, Lord, to build our confidence in you and learn to disregard the inabilities that we see in ourselves, so that we can do the work that you ask of us, bringing to all that you put in our path the good news that comes with your word, allowing all to know you, and then come to know you through the workings of your spirit in them. Thank you, Lord, for all that you do for us. Thank you for answered prayers. And thank you for your guidance in completing the tasks that were set before us this past week. Without you and your wisdom, we would never have been able to accomplish all that we had accomplished in our lives and in the life of the church. I thank you, Lord, for the leaders of this church that have been placed in the positions that allow your work to be done. You know we are needy people, and you know our every need. I ask you to help us decipher our wants from our needs, so that we look to you for what we truly need and not just what we want. Some of us need healing, so we lift to you all those that need physical, mental, or spiritual healing. We thank you for being with Cora, her son Lloyd, Inez, Corey, Beverly Warren, the Hum family. Dear Heavenly Father, we ask that you also be with Charles Warren. We ask you, dear Lord, to be with their medical teams. Allow them to have your wisdom. Allow them, dear Lord, to be your instruments this side of heaven for your healing to take place. We ask that you continue to walk with each and every one of them, bringing them comfort and continued healing. We join Dave in praising your name for little baby Jeanette. Dear Heavenly Father, those of us that are grandparents already know the joy that they will feel, especially when he holds this little baby for the first time. We praise your name, dear Lord, for bringing her into the world, and we ask that you continue to mold and shape her into the young woman you want her to be. We thank you, dear Lord, for all those that are out clearing our roads so that we can make it here today and get to the destinations you would have us go to today. We praise your name, dear Lord, for the linemen that climb the poles and fix the electric wires, dear Lord, so that we continue to have heat and light. Dear Heavenly Father, we ask that you keep them safe and keep them warm. Our world continues to be a mess. Thank you for the calm and peace that we can experience despite the mess. Some are not as blessed as we are, but we know that you are with them, just in a different way. Allow them to feel your presence and hear your voice despite the turmoil that is in their lives. We ask that you intervene, protect them from their enemies, and allow them to find the freedom that you intend for all of your children to have. For it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. If you would join with me in praying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen and amen.
Jesus, sing of you.
May I have the ushers come forward, please? Thanks.
Thank you.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you once again for the blessings that you continue to pour upon us. We thank you, dear Lord, for the gifts that have been given here today. We ask you, dear Lord, to bless these gifts. Continue to bless the givers and allow us, dear Lord, to use these gifts in a way that's pleasing to you. So I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please remain standing and join me in the prayer of dedication for these gifts we have just given. God of all wisdom, how often have we been deaf to your voice speaking to our hearts, especially when we live in a world that needs it so desperately. The reading from 1 Samuel brings us a phrase, the word of the Lord was rare in those days, which resonates with the relevance of the same generation. As we bring our gifts to be dedicated this morning, we pray that you might open our ears, open our hearts to hear where you call us to respond with obedience, so that we might do what we need to begin healing our world. In Christ we pray. Amen. Our next hymn is Here I Am, Lord, number 593 in the red.
Thank you.
Old Testament reading today comes from the book of 1 Samuel. For context, it's important to remember that Samuel was the person who God used to establish his kingship in all of Israel. And this is the story about God's calling of Samuel as a young man. I'm reading from chapter 3, verses 1 through 20 from the New International Version. The boy Samuel ministered before the Lord under Eli. In those days, the word of the Lord was rare. There were not many visions. One night, Eli, whose eyes were becoming so weak that he could barely see, was lying down in his usual place. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called Samuel. Samuel answered, "Here I am." And he ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, you called me." But Eli said, "I did not call. Go back and lie down." So he went and lay down. Again the Lord called Samuel. And Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, you called for me." "My son," Eli said, "I did not call. Go back and lie down." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord. The word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel a third time, and Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, you called me." Then Eli realized it was the Lord calling the boy. So Eli told Samuel, "Go and lie down, and if he calls you, say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went down and lay in his place. The Lord came and stood there, calling, as at the other times, "Samuel, Samuel." Then Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." And the Lord said to Samuel, "See, I am about to do something in Israel that will make the ears of everyone who hears of it tingle. At that time, I will carry out against Eli everything I spoke against his family, from beginning to end. For I told him that I would judge his family forever because of the sin he knew about. His sons made themselves contemptible, and he failed to restrain them. Therefore, I swore to the house of Eli, the guilt of Eli's house will never be atoned for by sacrifice or offering." Samuel lay down until morning and then opened the doors of the house of the Lord. He was afraid to tell Eli the vision, but Eli called him and said, "Samuel, my son?" Samuel answered, "Here I am." "What was it he said to you?" Eli asked. "Do not hide it from me. May God deal with you, be it ever so severely, if you hide anything from me that he told you." So Samuel told him everything, hiding nothing from him. Then Eli said, "He is the Lord. Let him do what is good in his eyes." The Lord was with Samuel as he grew up, and he let none of his words fall to the ground. And all Israel, from Dan to Beersheba, recognized that Samuel was attested as the prophet of the Lord. God bless the reading of God's holy word.
The gospel reading today comes from John chapter 1, verses 43 through 51. The following day, Jesus wanted to go to Galilee, and he found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." And Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him and said to him, "Behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom is no deceit." Nathanael said to him, "How do you know me?" Jesus answered and said to him, "Before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you." Nathanael answered and said to him, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered and said to him, "Because I said to you, I saw you under the fig tree, do you believe? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Most assuredly I say to you, hereafter you shall see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
I ask you, dear Lord, to breathe upon each and every one of us here your Holy Spirit, so that we hear your voice, we understand your words, and we leave your house this morning, dear Lord, with all that you have for us. And this I pray, dear Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. I love the story about Samuel. You can imagine, I believe Samuel was a young boy, like I can imagine, like Victoria, or maybe a little older. And they're getting ready to go to sleep, and Eli's sleeping in one room, and Samuel's making himself comfortable in his little bed that he made. And then all of a sudden, he hears someone calling him. And he gets up right away, and he runs into Eli's room, and he says, "Did you call me?" And Eli, probably tired, like me, being grumpy, saying, "I didn't call you, go back to bed," right? And then he gets called again. And after the third time Samuel gets called, Eli finally realizes, wait a second, I know who's calling you. And he tells him that it's God that's calling you. So the next time you hear this call, you say, "Lord, I hear you." Do you hear him calling you? Not yet, Victoria, but one day you will. God calls us when we least expect it. Matter of fact, I was like, one day last week, it was probably like 3 o'clock in the morning, 4 o'clock in the morning, I woke up wide awake, and I don't usually do that. I woke up wide awake, and I'm like, okay, I can't go back to sleep. It must be God calling me. Let's have a conversation. You know, what do you want me to think about? What do you want me to do, right? And I started just thinking about things in the church and stuff. And I said once before, you know, I'm always calling God at any time that I need him. Why not call me at 4 o'clock in the morning? Probably he knows that's one time that I'm actually not doing anything. And I have time to listen. When God calls us and asks us to do things, we kind of like sometimes think, really? I don't know about that. And I think about my calling. I believe I was called to be a pastor back when I was little. And I know some of you have heard my story, but some of you have not. But I have to tell you, I grew up in the Catholic Church. And I tell you, I love church. I love service. I love singing. I loved communion. And I'll tell you, I loved it so much that I used to play Mass with my brothers. We used to get the old missalettes, the nuns used to give them to me, and me and my brothers used to go down. We had this fake fireplace down in our rec room, and that would be my altar. And my brothers were on each end of the altar because they were my altar boys. And I used to get cherry pop for the wine and potato chips for the communion, and we used to have Mass. And I'm telling you what, I wasn't mocking it. It was a good feeling to do that. It was a good feeling. It was something that I loved to play. I loved the stories of the Bible, just like I love them today. I could hear the story of Samuel over and over again, and I could just envision it happening, and I love it. I didn't know that I was being called back then, but I remembered the feeling that it gave me. And when I was older, I was searching for that feeling. And I tried everything under the sun in the church to do. And I know the one guy said to me, "You know, Cindy, you have done everything from mopping the floors to preaching in the pulpit." And I did. I tried everything in the church. But it wasn't enough until I literally answered the call to be a pastor. You see, be a pastor isn't just preaching behind the pulpit. I did that when I was a lay speaker. Being a pastor is the line in that song, "Here I Am," the last line. "And I will hold your people in my heart." Whenever we sing that song and we sing that part, my heart is warmed, because that's what I believe I was made to do, is to hold his people in my heart. And love every single one of them with his love, not just mine. We had in our Bible study this past Wednesday, and I only had two people there with me, Ann and Nellie, but we had a good conversation. And one of the things we talked about was experience. And I said, we have to share our experiences. We have to share our callings with other people. We share our experiences with him so that others may see him in them, not just in us. Does that make sense? I want you to take some time this week and hear him calling you, because he never stops calling us. Right? Well, I was sitting over here and I was looking at all the people here in church, and I don't know some of you as much as I know others, but I can look at some people and I can say, you know, Ann, she's called to serve. And how do you know that? Is because she does it without thinking. And she does it well. Amen? Praise God for Ann. And we have Sally.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Sally was called to sing.
Oh, yes.
So much so, she says that the day she can't sing is the day she wants God to call her home. Call her home.
Amen.
And Karen.
Amen.
She loves children. If you see her in kids club around the children, she turns into the biggest kid ever. Amen? She loves children, and she makes them feel loved. But she shows God's love to each kid that comes into her life. She just made Victoria happy today, huh? walked into the office with a bag that had a unicorn and some unicorn marshmallows. And she, did you even know that she loved those unicorn marshmallows?
No, but they were with the unicorns, so I figured.
Yeah, those are her favorites. So she made her happy first thing this morning. We have Monica. You know, she lived her adult life working as a nurse. But she loves music. You can tell. Amen. And she felt God calling her to use her musical talents in this church. So praise God for that. Amen. And Steve also, with his musical talents. And I was just thinking, Steve, I know you always talk about Michael W. Smith, and you would love to be like Michael W. Smith one day when you grow up. You know he's going to be in camp in March. Yeah, I just saw that. But I praise God for Steve, and then you have Nellie. Nellie has a heart for the veterans. She said she would be in the military, but instead, she loves taking care of the veterans. That's a calling. That's something that was laid on her heart to do. And you know that it was laid on your heart because God allows you to do it well. Amen? And then I looked at George and I said, George, what was your calling? And I believe God said to me, you were called to be my husband. So that we can work together. Amen. And now, raise Victoria. And Victoria's going to have a calling, and one day you'll know what that is. But right now, you were just there to make everybody happy around you. And you do that well. Amen. I don't know probably the rest of you to know exactly what your calling is, so that just means I need to visit with you. Amen? Because each and every one of us have a calling. And I was thinking about Suzanne back there, because Suzanne, I feel like you have a lot of wisdom throughout the years to share that you've been in this church. You have a love of God. You have a great story in your husband. You love being in Sunday school, and you just need to keep on doing what you're doing. Amen. And Kay, all you need to do is smile. That's your calling. Just be in a room and smile, and you make us all smile too. I did ask Dave Tapman, since I knew that he was going to be liturgist today, to tell us a little bit about a calling that he has. So I'm going to ask him to share that now.
So when Pastor Cindy talked to me this week about sharing a point in my life where I thought God was calling me, I immediately thought of about a half a dozen or 10 different things. But the one I want to share with you is one of the great blessings of my life. Is that for 7 years I participated in a weekly men's Bible study in suburban Detroit that studied so much scripture that in fact it was said that we would study more scripture than most people in seminary. It was called Bible Study Fellowship. You may have heard of it. The format was such that we met every week as a large group. Every Monday night at 7 o'clock, I walked into a suburban Metro Detroit church with 450 other men who were all studying the same Word of God. The structure was such that we would meet in a large group, sing a few hymns, and break into small groups of 15 to 20 men, and we had discussion questions that we were responsible to work on all week long. They were separated by day of the week, and our job was to answer those questions. And then in our discussion group, our job was to respond to the discussion group's questions about those questions. After the discussion group was over, we reconvened back in the sanctuary, and our teaching leader, who's the overall leader of the class, would give us a lecture on that scripture. As I said, this went on for 7 years. We covered a number of different books of the Bible. In the first 4 years that I was in it, I worked at a transmission plant in Toledo, Ohio. The commute was about an hour and 15 or hour and 15 minutes, about an hour and a half each way. And but I was so enthused by the Bible Study Fellowship study that I made class every week. I made some special provisions to get there. Shortly after I began BSF, I was approached by our teaching leader, a great guy named Jim Melville, about becoming a discussion leader. One of those men who would take that small group of men, 15 to 20 men, and talk about those questions that we were supposed to answer. And I was like, but Jim, thank you, but no way. I mean, I'm busy, I'm a plant manager for General Motors. I queued up an hour and a half each way. There's just no way. I said, okay, fine. So then he came back a year or two later. I was still in Toledo, still working in Toledo. And he said, Dave, he says, I think God is calling you to be a discussion leader. I saw Jim, well, thank you, that's very complimentary. I did not sense God's call because I wasn't attuned to it. And I said, Jim, I'm way too busy. I'm even more engaged. We're making 2.5 million transmissions a year. I hardly have time to see my kids, blah, blah, blah. And he said, okay. So fast forward, in my fourth year of BSF, I got transferred to the plant in Livonia, Michigan, which is about 10 minutes from this church that I've been at by BSF. And so, for the third time, as God called Samuel, which is an interesting coincidence, probably not a coincidence, probably a God thing, Jim came to me and said, Dave, you've been telling me that you couldn't do this because the commute was so far. I know now your commute is 10 minutes. So, will you be a discussion leader? And I said, okay, Jim, I'll be a discussion leader. I came to recognize that was not Jim Delco, this grandfatherly figure who gave us a lecture and run and told corny dad jokes. It was God. It was God who was calling me to be a discussion leader, to bond with this group of 15 to 20 men every week and go through the questions with them, and then talk to them about personal issues. Every week we ended the session by talking about who had prayer requests or whatever else was going on. It's a way of, in a way, kind of the pastoral responsibility of being in life more than just being in the pulpit. So, while I said there were many examples where God called me to things, this was a clear and very, very real calling from God to me. And it was a great privilege of mine. I got far more out of the study as a discussion leader than I did as a participant. So there's one God's calling.
Yeah, thank you. And like I said, God calls each and every one of us. And if you don't know what he's calling you to do right now, I ask you, I challenge you to sit and be still and hear him calling you this week for something. And I know he will, because we just need to be open. You know, in our gospel reading, we had Philip going to tell Nathaniel that he found the one. He found the one that was promised to them. And Nathaniel didn't believe it until Jesus said to him, I saw you under that fig tree before Nathaniel came and got you, or Philip came and got you. He needed some confirmation before he believed that he was really the one. And God knows that we need confirmation to know that it's him that's calling us. And I will guarantee you that he will give you that confirmation, just like Dave shared today. And when you're in it, when you're doing what God wants you to do, you know it. There's a light bulb that goes on. There's a warmth. I find it interesting because Victoria talks about her heart being warmed all the time, and I'm like, where did she get that from, right? But that is, seriously, when your heart is warmed, that is the love of God in your heart. There's no doubt about that. So please join with me in prayer. Oh, dear Heavenly Father, I thank you, dear Lord, for the callings that you have already given to us. I thank you for allowing us to be your instruments this side of heaven. I know, dear Lord, that this world still needs your instruments. And I ask you, dear Lord, to give us the courage and the strength to say, here am I, send me. know, dear Lord, that you equip us with all that we need. Words to say, time to give. Any excuse we can come up with, dear Lord, you can erase them. So I ask you, dear Lord, to open our minds, open our hearts, and help us, dear Lord, to willingly say, send me. In this I pray, dear Lord, in Jesus' name, amen. If you would join with me now in singing Shine, Jesus Shine, from the Faith We Sing book on page 2173. And that is what we are all called to do, is let Jesus shine.
Thank you.
said,
Amen.